Mark Bosnich is one of the outstanding young goalkeepers to have emerged from the Premiership. Born in Australia, he joined Aston Villa in 1992. Mark Bosnich displays all the skills a goalkeeper needs. He dominates the penalty area and instills confidence in his defenders. He has tremendous ability and speed around the box, and his skill and confidence make him a difficult man to beat.
A goalkeeper, in my opinion, is the jewel in the crown. You can have the greatest attacking team in the world, but without the base, the foundation of a goalkeeper and a good defence, the house falls down around it. The essential attributes to be a successful keeper can be broken down into handling, taking crosses, agility and kicking, which has come more and more into the game since the back pass law. Then you've got fitness components, which include agility, speed, strength, reaction time, and the last one is recognition or eye speed. I do believe that goalkeeping is a specialised position, and the majority of the time you should be set aside on your own to practice your own techniques, and you can't train the same as outfield players. For the majority, you have to train as a goalkeeper. I mean, even as down to the warm-up, you should be warming up as a goalkeeper. There's no use warming up as an outfield player when you have to go into a shooting session, because it'll take you 10 to 15 minutes of the shooting session to warm up. Anaerobically, we have to be very fit. Also, in terms of power and strength, we take on a whole different way of training to prepare ourselves for what is ahead. When we move our bodies, we're more like a cat. And a cat, if you know, when it springs, uses every part of its body. So every muscle is just as important as the next one. The main type of weight training is done with freestanding weights, because machine weights are totally no use for my position, because you're using very static movements and isolating parts of the body. So I would use freestanding weights, and I'd also stick to the core exercises like bench press, which uses every part of the upper half of the body, power cleans, which uses every part of the body, and squats, which uses every part of the lower half of the body. And those type of exercises I only stick to once or twice per week. During the season, I'd alternate between heavy weights, very low reps, and I mean 1 to 3 reps for pure explosion, and just maintenance phase.
Go.
Agility is another vital part of goalkeeping. In a crowded area, the ball often takes a deflection, so the keeper going one way may have to check and turn the other.
Agility comes under the wider scope of flexibility and able to move your body at great speed and force in a short period of time, be able to stop and to check and to be able to get your body in elastic positions. There's dynamic flexibility, which is the range of movement which I'd work on every day. And then there's the developmental flexibility, which is stretching, making sure the limbs are supple enough to be able to make these movements come match day.
Yeah.
as a goalkeeper, to have a centre of gravity and a balance is so important, because if you're off skew, you might be able to save a shot if it goes right, but if it goes left, you're not able to do it. And I think in any sport, I mean, balance is something that I think we just disregard, because we, again, regard it as something that you're endowed with naturally. But it is so important, and it can be worked on. I've got a simple exercise of standing on two tennis balls and on the balls of my feet and trying to hold my balance for as long as possible without tilting onto the front of my feet or to the back of my feet. And the improvement comes by testing. One day, obviously, if I do 30 seconds, the next day I'll be looking to do 35. You can actually work on it and improve these things, which is the most important thing. You can improve your eyesight. You can improve your peripheral awareness. You can improve how quickly you react to the ball, which is really down to your eyes. The exercises are very simple. You have flip cards, and the exercise on that is to flip them and to start recognizing numbers quicker and quicker. And the quicker you recognize the numbers, obviously, the more your eyes are working.
4, 2, 5, 8, 3, 8. King, queen, queen, 5, 5, 4, king, 10, 9, 2, 6, 3, king, 10, king, jack, 8, 9, 7, 5, 8, 3.
There's the other one where you get, say, a string with beads attached to it that can move up and down. And this comes under peripheral awareness, where you try to align the beads with somebody holding the string on the other side in line with each other. And again, you can check how much the beads are aligned together. The advantage of all these exercises is the judgment of distances quickly, and to recognize the flight, the speed of the ball quicker than anyone else can, which again sends the signals to the brain, which sends the signals to the body, starts the chain reaction, which sets the save in motion.
The goalkeeper's view of the ball will often be obscured until the very last second, so he must be alert and able to respond quickly.
The best exercises to increase speed around the box is the closest thing that you encounter in a game, covering short distances at great speed and then having someone firing a ball at you to make a save.
The coach or whoever is serving would say just outside the 6-yard box, and I would jog out to the 6-yard box, check on the 6-yard line, and the ball would be going back over my head. Again, that comes more along the lines of speed agility, and you've got to check, shift your body weight, and then have the power and the strength of your legs to elevate yourself up and flick the ball over. That is an exercise I would use 3 to 4 times a week. When I'd be laying on my side, with my hand on the post, laying on my side, and again somebody would shout up and hit the ball towards the other corner, so I'd have to get up as quickly as possible. Again, that's a speed agility exercise. I will start on one ball and usually go 3 times around a triangle. This is, again, a lot of speed, and it's also good technical work for your feet and hands. Maybe get somebody to time me how quick I was 3 times around the triangle and 3 times the other way.
qualities of stamina and agility are both important, but the main essential is the keeper's ability to handle the ball safely. The basis of good goalkeeping is a good pair of hands.
The correct way to handle the ball by what we call like a spiderweb technique, which is your two hands spread out with the two thumbs meeting in the middle. That is the correct way to catch a ball from shoulder high upwards. The correct way to catch a ball if it's around medium high is to let it come into your chest and then to wrap the arms right around the ball and bring it nicely into your chest. And the lower ball from your knees down to your feet, again with the palms facing outwards and this time with the two little fingers virtually touching. So again, you've got first of all your hands to the back of the ball and then your body follows. Those are the three main ways we deal with the balls that are coming virtually straight to you. When we dive, we incorporate the same techniques. We use the spiderweb technique. When we're diving, we get the hands to the back of the ball first, and then the rest of the body follows, because the first basic principle of goalkeeping is to get the body behind the ball, and that should be paramount in your mind when you're thinking about diving and saving. The safest way to land is with the first part that hits the ball, which should be the hands, and that should be the first part then to come and hit the ground. In a nice looping motion, you come down with the ball first and let the rest of the body follow, in which case when you've hit the ball on the ground you can cushion the rest of your body. When you're never confident on catching the ball, the best thing to do is get the ball as far away from you as possible, ideally away from the danger area, and that's straight down the middle. So if somebody's shooting, you try to look for distance and towards the side of the goals, because invariably if you knock the ball, parry the ball, as we say, straight down the middle, somebody will be following in and I'll have the whole goal to shoot at again. If you parry the ball to the side, you again automatically decrease their chances of scoring because they come from a far, far greater angle. What you're looking for really is time to recover and to get back and get back into position. If we can't get to the cross with our both hands to catch, we'd use the punch then. And it's a little bit risky because to punch a ball while you're diving, the ball can spin off your hands rather awkwardly and end up in the goal.
One way to judge a goalkeeper's competence is to watch the way he deals with crosses. Crosses are the most difficult part of a keeper's game.
Crosses are perhaps what separates the good goalkeepers from the great ones. It's an opportunity to show how well you can dominate your box. And the best way to deal with him is, one, to make your mind up very early, as soon as the guy strikes the ball, for you to be virtually starting to come. And two, obviously, communication with defenders. You've got to have a relationship whereby they know if you're going to come or if you're going to stay. The worst thing you want to avoid on crosses is indecision. And three is the strength and the agility to be able to make the catch and under usually heavy challenge to take the ball cleanly and come away with it. Because any defense will tell you the cross ball is one where you're very vulnerable at. And if your goalkeeper can come and take crosses regularly, it takes so much pressure off defenders and it's such a confidence booster for the rest of the team. The cross should be taken at its highest possible point because you've got the advantage of using your hands and that's the only advantage you've got over the rest of the outfield players, and you've got to use that advantage at all times.
Probably the most difficult of all crosses is the low one. Not only does the dive out need to be perfectly timed, but it often involves diving in a place where the boots are flying. It's a dive which requires confidence, understanding, and daring.
Diving at an attacker's feet, the most important thing to remember is, first of all, your hands as a barrier. Your hands go to the back of the ball, in front of your face, which protects the face, and follow through with the rest of your body. This is something that has to be practiced and practiced and practiced to perfection, because when we're talking, we are talking physical danger here. If you get this technique wrong, sometimes you can pay for it.
But it's no good knowing how to take the ball from somebody's feet without understanding the basic principles of narrowing the angle.
When you're narrowing the angle, you have to have an imaginary triangle virtually from each post to where the kicker is positioned, and you've got to be optimally placed right in the middle of that triangle, not too far forward so you can get chipped, not too far back so he's got much more of the goal to aim at, not too far to the left so you leave on the right, and not too far to the right so you leave on the left. So it's got to be an optimal position in the middle of that triangle that you position yourself so you know you're giving the striker as little of the goal to aim at as possible. The 18-yard box is your kingdom. There can be no argument, there can be no dissent. There's got to be one voice and that's it, and everyone else has got to fall into line. I've got the best view on the pitch, and I decide what happens, when it happens. When the action is coming close, you've got to remind yourself and concentrate on your own job. Organisation on corners and so forth. I take that as a personal slight if a goal goes in from a corner or from a set play. So I've got to make it 100% in my mind that I've done everything possible to pull people into position and make sure they're doing their jobs.
Complete authority over his own defenders at set pieces is a goalkeeper's right and his responsibility. He must make sure that they protect him and the goal as much as they can.
Organising my wars is simply done by having one person who turns around and faces me, and I line him up between the ball and the post. I'm on the post and I'll line him up so he's at least one player over on the other side of the post, so it covers that side of the goal. And to be honest, if it was down to me, I'd change that law and I'd make sure that any free kick you couldn't have a war. I think it'd be a great contest between the person who's striking the ball and the goalkeeper. But as the law stands, depending how close it is and how central it is, would depend how many people I'd have in the war.
The back pass law has had a profound influence on the keeper's role. He now has to possess some outfield skills, such as controlling and passing the ball.
The back pass has changed goalkeeping to the extent that, whereas in the old days, when you were 1-0 up and under a lot of pressure and somebody could pass the ball back to you, you could pick the ball up to you, no problem, slow the game down and virtually kill time and kill the game. Whereas these days, when you're under pressure and they pass the ball back to you, now you've got to have the presence of mind and the technique and skill to be able to knock a 50 to 60 yard ball to safety, really. Ball control has become more important because of the back pass law. The majority of back passes that you deal with, you have to hit them first time anyway. But it has become far more important because of that law, and you have to practice it accordingly.
best type of research you can do on individual strikes, actually to watch them in practice and to pick up any type of pattern, any type of instinct that, you know, during the pressure cooker situation when you haven't got time to think, that they'll revert to 9 times out of 10. 75% of what you learn in a pressure cooker situation usually goes out the window. But it's a 25% that's been drummed into you continually over a period of time, which you'll stick to. Because you've trained so hard for so long, you still hold on to that little bit of 25% that you know, and that can mean a difference. That becomes your instinct, your second nature, that when pressure's on, that you rely on this. And if you can pick up this type of thought pattern in the striker by watching him over a period of time, then you'll know when it comes to that split second, you'll be able to explode one way or the other that, again, can make the difference. Penalty should be scored. There's no doubt about that. I think it's 94% of penalties are scored. But again, the psychological effect that you can have, and even the effect you can have on the actual game by saving a penalty, even if you're 1-0 down, you save a penalty, it's enormous. I mean, people don't actually realise how important it can be. So you've got to make plans accordingly. Again, the best practice is to have people take penalties against you. But if you, you know, if you're really clued in and you know who you're playing the following week, you will do research and you'll know who their penalty taker is. And you know, you'll know where he has gone, which side he put it to the last time he took it. It can help a lot in today's world when it's such a fine line between success and failure. It could just be that difference. Passing the ball out to the defence comes down really to the style of the play your team is incorporating. More and more we're leaning towards in this country, playing the ball out from the back and being very patient and building in that way. But again, there's a lot of things to take in consideration. There's no use playing out from the back if you're under intense pressure and, you know, their strikers are pushed up and it's 3 against 2 and you're going to be in, you know, put your team under pressure if you play out from the back. You've got to use common sense in these things. Sometimes the best ball to play is a long ball forward because it's 2 against 2 and, you know, you can actually set up a goal. You can, I remember, goalkeeper is the last line of defence, but it can be the first line of attack.
being a goalkeeper is everything to me. I think a lot of people in our business tend to get sidetracked. They lose sight of what got them there in the first place, which is their football, in my case, which is my goalkeeping. And especially when it gets taken away from you in the times that it has done, you realise how important it is for you for this period of my life. I still got a long way to go, a lot to learn. I'd like to think I'm a team goalkeeper, that I actually make a difference to the team that I'm playing in, and that when people play with me, they recognise that I do make a difference.